Hi, and welcome back to Mingus on Tech. I'm Ken Mingus, Executive Editor at Computer World. I'm here with Sharon Maklis. She's our Director of Editorial Data and Analytics for IDG. We're going to be talking about Alexa and skills and how to make your own. Some coding involved, so get ready. Okay, so Sharon, we always think about Alexa. Well, many people think about Alexa with the Echo Dot and the Echo at home. But apparently, as you have found out, there's a lot that people can do to customize the skills and the kinds of things that the Amazon Alexa ecosystem can deliver. So I wanted to find out a little bit. You've done some coding on your own. I'm not a coder, so I'm going to ask broad questions, and you can explain to me what it is that that you've done. But so tell me. All right. So if I'm interested in doing some of my own skills and coding my own skills, how difficult is that to do, and what kinds of things can be done?
Well, Amazon has come out with some skills templates for people to follow if they want to get started easily. So if you know a little code, you can customize what they already have built. Team lookup directory, quiz games, Minecraft helper. They have a whole bunch of things. So that's a really good way to start. The platform that they use the most for these templates is JavaScript and Node.js. I actually don't know that much Node. And by that much, I mean hardly at all.
Okay.
But if you know general coding principles, it's kind of easy to do basic customization. If you want to get more elaborate about it, you can actually analyze or do your data in another language and then port it back into the skill, which I actually have done for a couple. There is also a Python library for building these. Unfortunately, I don't know much Python either. So I do my data work in R and then put it back into the skill. So that's possible if you're an R person or a Ruby person to do it like that.
So there's not necessarily an R library of things. You have to sort of like take
no,
it out
sadly,
to the
back. No, sadly, no. Not R. Not yet?
I know you love R.
Yes, I do. You can actually host these skills anywhere on any server, but it's easiest to use the AWS Lambda. And Lambda only supports a couple of platforms, and R, sadly, is not one of them, although I have brought that up.
Okay, I'm sure you have. All right, so in terms of what you've done, I mean, tell me, you've already coded something that you've got out in the wild. You can do things that are sort of public-facing. You can do skills and things that are sort of personalized, basically personalizing your own Alexa. So what have you done?
That's the thing that I think a lot of people don't think about. People who have coding skills, when you think about writing a skill for Alexa, you think about publishing something into the Amazon ecosystem for anyone to use, which is one thing to do. But you can also write your own skills and just use them in your own account. If you want to share them with family and friends, they have something that they call beta testing, and you can have up to 500 people invited to your beta test, and that will last, I forget if it's 3 or 6 months, but it's a way to share your skill with others without having it
go public.
Yeah,
basically.
So for example, I'm working on my own phone book just for my own contacts. Obviously, I don't want to publish that anyplace else.
not intentionally, anyway. Yeah.
I have a stock skill. So for this company stocks that I follow for work that I want to keep track of, I have my own skill just for me to say, Alexa, open my stocks. And it reads me the latest prices and the changes, which of course anyone could do for their own stock portfolio. There are stock portfolios that you can tap into.
Pre-done?
Yeah. But I find that it doesn't really work very well for adding just stocks that aren't in your own brokerage house.
Right.
But there's plenty already out there, but maybe it doesn't do exactly what you want. The other thing is, if you have some of these skills and you want to be a hero locally, a skill doesn't have to be a nationwide interest. It can be very local. I published one skill for the town of Framingham that just is a calendar reader. And Amazon has published a template for a calendar reader, so you can customize that fairly easily to read a Google Calendar. I did some extra work because I wanted to customize the way the dates are read, so I did some of that in R. But the basics are already available. So, I mean, think about events in your community, or if there's a like small community arts organization, how
or
nice
a local
that would
nonprofit
be.
That might need some, they want to get some publicity out using Alexa. This would be a way for someone to do some coding, simple coding that might help them spread the word, whatever
yes,
it is.
Or in the workplace, if you have events at your company, you may want to do that. Real estate company may want to have. I mean, all sorts of things you can do, with the understanding that you have to understand your customer demographic and how many people are likely to have these devices. In the case of the Framingham area, it's a very high-tech area, so a lot of people are earlier adopters.
Right. Do you find, you know, having created some of these skills that you, the private ones that you're using at home, or, you know, that you might share with friends and family, does that increase how often you're turning to Alexa for, you know, stock reports, weather reports, phone book, things like that? Do you find you're using it more?
Absolutely. And I find that I'm asking it every day what's happening in Framingham, and or more correctly, Alexa, ask Framingham events.
Really?
What's happening today? It's a nice way to see what's happening over the weekend if I want to make plans. Mm-hmm. You know, yeah, you could go to the web and look, but this is much cooler.
How involved, how long does it take? I mean, obviously, every skill that you're going to develop is going to differ. But, I mean, roughly, say someone who's got some basic coding knowledge and decides that they want to do a skill, either, you know, personal or public, rough guess as to how long that takes? I mean, you've got to get the template, maybe, if you want to get that from Amazon. You've got to customize it. There are a variety of steps. You know, the story that you wrote for InfoWorld, which is what prompted my interest in this, has a very detailed look at step-by-step-by-step how to do this with a lot of granular detail. How long does something like that take?
I mean, to be fair, the one I did for InfoWorld, which is a site for developers, was fairly complex.
Right.
And that one would take maybe a few hours.
Okay.
To
dedicated
customize.
Time.
Yeah.
Really, yeah.
But if you want to do something simpler, like just a quiz game or look up certain facts, I mean, if you're following the template and you're happy with what they did, I mean, you could do this in an hour.
Okay. Just tweaking what they've done already,
yeah,
with whatever specifics you need.
But you also need to understand how it works.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, and they have pretty good instructions. You've got to, if you've done websites, you can think of it, the voice interface is the front end, and that's a separate area that you develop on the Amazon developer portal.
Mm-hmm.
And then the back end is sort of like your web server, and that's someplace, that's something code to make the front end work that you need to host someplace. You can really host it on any server, but the easiest thing by far would be to just host it on AWS Lambda, which is their serverless platform.
Right. Is there, you know, we were talking about this earlier, that one of the things you have to keep in mind is that when coding for something that's going to be voice activated, you either have to be a little more specific or you have to include some variables in there depending on how people might be asking for the information that they're seeking, right? It's not like coding for the web per se.
Yeah, it's a different experience. You have to anticipate what people might ask and then kind of lead them on a path. You also want to make it a little interesting and engaging. I went to an Amazon day-long workshop on developing these skills, and one of the things they said is if you want to make it engaging for people to come back and enjoy using it, you might want to randomize your messages. So instead of always hearing the same thing, you have a set of different messages that it says based on a certain condition. The Fitbit skill is really great at that. When you reach your step goal, there are multiple different things it will say. Each time it's different. So it's, if each time it just said, congratulations, you met your goal, that's, you know, after the 73rd time you've used it, it's kind of boring.
Well, you need to reward people in some way, and I would think...
And
that,
entertain them.
Right, exactly. Well, yeah, and that's what I mean, because especially when, you know, we're getting into this world in technology now where so much information is not just typing in some words in a search box. There are more variables. You've got different ways of accessing things by voice, whether it's something like Alexa or Siri or at home, in the car, on your phone. And it sounds like to me that there's an added level of complexity that's going to be built into that. I think that's why, you know, voice assistants are not always as good as we'd like for them to be yet. I mean, did you find that? Did you have to sort of rethink how you think of coding when you were working on these skills?
Yes, because you have to, one of the things you do with the voice interface is give it sample questions of what someone might want to ask. And there is some artificial intelligence built in so that if it's somewhat different than what you're asking, it still understands. But if it's completely different, it may not understand. So it's helpful to see how people interact with it. I mean, if you're serious about this. But, you know, just getting back to why you'd want to do this, I'm expecting a lot of people are going to be getting these devices for the holidays.
Right.
And it would be really cool if you could help them get more out of it. Or maybe you're going to get one for the holidays and to get more out of it. But you can make it a little more personal. I think Alexa has a pretty good personality, but there are certain basic things it still doesn't do. For example, I'd like to be able to ask it the phone number for one of my contacts, and it literally doesn't do that yet, which is sort of weird.
Yeah.
It will make phone calls if you ask it, but it won't tell you the phone number. if it's
is that some sort of privacy thing maybe that's built in as a security thing?
I mean, it could be, although it does access to the information. To your contacts. I mean, it may just be that it wants you to use Alexa to make the phone calls, and they just really haven't thought of it.
Yeah. Okay. So in terms of projects coming up, you've done the Framingham thing. Any other project, any skills projects that you've got on the back burner now?
Yes, I'm actually in the midst of typing in the data for my own phone book because I love that. If I'm sitting at my desk to say, I'm typing something and I need someone's address to just be able to say that. I mean, yeah, I'm sitting at the computer. I could look it up, but what fun is that?
Yeah, no, have Alexa do it.
And I'm also working on a second skill for a local community organization. They were thrilled. I had a beta test of it, and it happens to be an organization with a lot of tech people, and they're really excited about it. So it's really, if you're interested in doing this, that's a great way to learn and also do some good in your community or for some other kind of nonprofit.
I would also think, too, that, you know, if you are a coder, it would be smart to be, at least understand how this whole system kind of works. Even if you're not going to be doing a lot of personalizing yourself, given where technology is going, you know, you're going to need to know these kinds of things 5-10 years down the road, just as a skill, I mean, a personal skill.
It's certainly useful to say you can do. And interestingly, when Google Home first came out, it was very limited in terms of what third parties can do. And they have recently announced a platform where you can create your own skills for it now also. It used to be kind of closed to a certain amount of partners. And, you know, that's kind of next on my to-do list.
Okay. I was going to say, what's coming up next? All right. I'm just wondering if there's any advice or anything that you might be able to offer for someone who's interested in doing this. Is there a particular language people should be focused on understanding or knowing? Or?
Yeah, I mean, JavaScript and Node.js would be probably the best.
Those are the two.
To know. And, I mean, Node is really hot now anyway, so, I mean, it's a good thing to know.
Yeah. Okay, good. All right, so just in time for the holidays, ways to personalize your Alexa and make it something you can do, you know, either privately or publicly. Sharon, thanks for stopping by to talk about it. We'll see what happens after the holidays and check back and see what other skills you've come up with.
Thanks, Ken.
For now, that's a wrap.